There we go. Go share.
All right, everybody, good evening and welcome to Kingdom Dynamics. This is Dr. Bill with World Bible School, and we're glad that some of you are joining us tonight. Good to see Dr. Faye joining us tonight, and her office staff is watching, and good to see other people who are chiming in even right now, and we'll be watching the show as we go. So we appreciate all of you. During my pre-show broadcast, I read Dr. Roy's bio. I appreciate this brother very much. And he is on with me tonight, and we have a dynamic topic for you tonight. But before we begin, I'd just like to give him an opportunity to say a word and just anything that God's doing that you'd like to share. Welcome to the show, Dr. Roy.
Thank you very much. I always enjoy being with you and always enjoy being able to talk to people around the world. We were just discussing before we went on here how our ministry has really changed in probably the last 10 years or previous in the past. And I'm so thankful for Zoom meets. I'm so thankful for Facebook because we're reaching people everywhere. Sometimes I'll cry a little bit about not having a congregation, you know, to go to and see and love on. But there's nothing like getting to talk to people. On Messenger, you can talk to anybody. You can video anybody in the world, and we get to do that a lot. So it's a privilege, and you know, the Lord just got me on the same path that I've been on for a long time, just taking the Word of God and grinding it out, making it understandable, translating, and for the last probably about 6 months to 8 months, I've been teaching on the divine mind, and I've got one book I'm getting ready to publish. I'll be doing this one I'm doing now pretty soon. But in this second session, I was really led to be talking about the divine faculty. You know, you hear sometimes, you've heard about how people have mental problems and the doctors say they've lost their faculties. Well, that's a terrible position to be in. You can't function. And so if we have faculties, which we do, there's 12 of them that are divine, and we'll talk about them here in a little bit. We need to know what they are, and we need to allow the very spirit of God inside of us to energize those so we can function out of our divine faculties and not just carnal faculties. So that's what I've been teaching, and you know, that's what we talked about. We'll discuss a few of them tonight.
Yes, absolutely. And that's what we're talking about tonight, the awakening of the divine faculties in all people. You know, I did a video one time about what I believe about all religions, and that God didn't necessarily start all religions, but God is in all people of all religions, and that, you know, this thing about all people has really been a struggle for mainline Christendom, at least. But the fact is, you're right, within all mankind, not some of mankind, but all mankind,
right. There
is a need for our divine faculties to be awakened to the truth of Father's mind, his divine mind, and which we were created in. That's who we are. If you talk about an inheritance, that's our inheritance. That's our origin. And so I want to just let you kick this off tonight. I know that we have some scripture prepared, particularly from your translation, as you've been translating many passages, but what about this, where people are struggling along, even if they're mentally struggling along, they're having their good days and their bad days, and sometimes mostly bad days, but all of a sudden they have a divine awakening. Do you think that's going to happen in everybody sooner or later?
I believe so. I mean, some people, they may end up, their body is not able to hold them. But I think when that happens, they're going to come to a great awareness right then. You know, some people think that after the body lets go of you, that you're still learning, and that's possible. But I believe that it includes everyone. You know, that's one, like you said, that's one of the biggest debates that I receive sometimes on my post. And, you know, eventually the person just needs to just leave me because they don't want to hear the truth. But when you say that everybody was included in what Father did, I mean, most people can't even take the fact that everyone was included in what Jesus revealed. But mm-hmm. Jesus revealed what Father did from the foundation. And when you begin to teach people that all people are righteous, all people are holy, all people are in contact with Father, but they're not aware of it. And of course, I use the word contact with the word, because the word Christ, the root word to the word Christ is actually contact. And staying in contact with Father, we have contact because we're one with our Father, but we don't always listen to our Father. And so the Apostle Paul, he had his great experience, and he explained it in Galatians. And I was talking to you about the other day. I forgot that. I've even translated the book of Galatians. I got the whole thing translated. So I need to get it published pretty quick. But I'm going to read this from my translation. I'm going to start with verse 19 and go down to verse 22.
Yes.
And the word I, when you look it up in the Greek where he said, for I am dead, it's ego. You look it up, it says ego, and it's me, myself, and I. So Paul was saying that I used to live all to myself. I didn't know that I was one with Father God. So he said, for I am dead to all hope and expectation of help or rescue from the law. And now I live by putting all my faith in constant contact with Father as Jesus did, and out of that life. Verse 20, the ego in my life, which is the I, me, myself, and I, has died when Jesus allowed the Pharisees to kill him. And that's what happened. Jesus literally drew all man's confusion into himself. And that's when ego died. And so he said, when Jesus allowed the Pharisees to kill him, he bore that confusion. Nevertheless, I'm energized and reanimated in my whole man, no longer me as separate, but now I know I am one with Father God. That's one of the greatest needs for people today to know, is that one with Father, and they were always one with Father, and there's nothing you can do to become one when you already are. So he said that, I am one with Father God, with a relation of rest given to me from the foundation of the world. Now I live out of my holy breath, which is the real meaning of spirit. Yet I'm still Paul, but I was quickened, revived, and pushed forward in every part of my being by the true life, which is Zoe life, and you also. I now live, or we can say experience, in my body as a God-man. That would be spiritual. And verse 21, and being energized and revitalized now, I live as holy breath in my entire being, out of and by faith as a son of God, or we could say also a daughter of God, just as Jesus did, who loved me and all, and gave himself to put an end to all that traduced man. I do not set aside the redemptive work of Jesus for all, for if righteousness is acquired by the law, then Jesus entered into the judgment of the Pharisees and the Mosaic law and melted away, brought it to naught, which is the meaning of destroyed, vanished away and made void, and it no longer exists, and to be any works is destroyed of righteousness. In other words, the law to become who you really are. So yes. That is the experience that Paul explained to the church at Galatia. I'm sorry, I didn't turn my phone off. I heard to turn this off before we started, and I didn't obey.
Yeah, but that might have been God calling.
Yes, it probably was, and it's okay. But that's the experience that everybody needs to have.
You know, before the show, in the pre-show, for those that didn't get to see the pre-show announcement an hour before, I did announce that one of the things Dr. Roy has done over his ministry lifetime, at some point, it's really became more of a, not just a theologian, but a scribe. And, you know, I appreciate that about the first century scribes, even though they were off to some degree, still, here you are able in our modern time to translate scripture. And as you said one time on one of my shows, you may not translate the entire Bible, but you've certainly translated quite a bit of it. And I for one, want to say that I have a great appreciation for that. So I posted your, at least just verse 20 of your translation in the chat room. But
good. I've got a large document with them. I need to get busy and just focus myself on that pretty soon. and get that published, because, you know, it won't be the entire Bible, but it'd be a lot of verses that was, there was a lot of confusion in those verses. Mm-hmm. So I think it'll help a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, we want to bring forth this realization into substance. It's one thing to know something's true, but until you have the substance of it, and that's the substance of the truth, and you can walk out of it, it really not helps. It's not helping us. And what we want to do, what Scripture says, it says we are, John the Baptist said this, make ready the way of the Lord. And he wasn't really, you know, physically, he was talking about Jesus, but spiritually understanding that, he was talking about make way the way of the Father. And we do that throughout our entire consciousness. It's something that we have a choice. You know, you can choose to listen to the voice of the Spirit. You can listen to the spiritual understanding of the Word of God and make way for that. Or you can say, no, I'm happy where I'm at. And, you know, it is a choice. And I tell people all the time on Facebook, when they write me and they want to debate me and tell me I'm wrong, I just say, I understand where you're coming from and bless you. And then you just have to let them go.
Yeah. Yeah. I have been there. You know, when you teach things about awakening and awareness and about connecting with who God created you as from the beginning of time, there are a lot of people, especially, and I hate to say this being the founder of World Bible School University, but there are college graduates, Bible college graduates, theologians that really want to debate that from a traditional point of view. And I've had to walk away from conversations and say, you know what, I'm going to love you no matter what. Right. I remember recently someone told me you need to repent and you need to ask God to help you to get straightened out. And it's like, okay, whatever.
Well, I've had people tell me I need to get saved. I lost my salvation. You know, and I understand. I mean, I know both of you and I have degrees and I'm very glad I have them. And you have a Bible college, and I have three master's degrees. I have a doctorate's degree. But I put no faith in any of that for what we're learning today. But what has helped me is I'm able to go back to what I learned and say, okay, this is the spiritual picture of that. But too many people think just because they have a doctorate's degree or a master's degree and they studied that historical stuff, that's the only truth there is. Mm-hmm. But there's levels of understanding, just like school. We've said it before. I have. There's grade school, there's high school, and then there's college. And so in grade school, there's a certain truth, but it's not all the truth. And so, you know, Brother Garner used to say, people are stuck in the middle. They're stuck somewhere and they're not willing to come out. But Father's trying to dig them up and it's time to let go.
So one of the things I noticed, Dr. K said this in a little while ago, that there are 12 areas of our divine faculties that we can awaken to, and you somehow have tied these to the names of the disciples.
Right.
And I think people would be very interested in knowing about that.
Right. Good. Well, see, our Father's thoughts, our thoughts become our thoughts when we start functioning out of these divine faculties, and when we live out of them, and when they're energized by the very Spirit of God. And again, when we make ready for this to happen. So basically, there's all kinds of 12s in the Bible. There's the 12 tribes of Israel. There's the 12 wells of Elam. There's all kinds of 12 that you can attribute these things to. But I just happen to want to do the disciples with this. So the first 12 disciples, when I look them up and I look up their meanings of their names, for instance, Peter, we're going to talk about Peter a little bit tonight, but Peter represents faith. And that's in the center of our head. It's in the pineal gland. And you've heard Kay talk about that a lot, and I'll talk about some more tonight. The second one is Andrew, which represents strength, and it's in the small of the back, and because it all applies to our body. You know, too many people want to leave the body out, and they just want to be some floating spirit somewhere someday. But these bodies were wonderfully and fearfully made, and we are the very body of God. There's one body, and this is a God body. And so we need science has discovered all kinds of stuff, so we really need to understand the makeup of our body, the makeup of it, and how it releases the very life of God to flow through us. And then number three is judgment, which is James, the son of Zebedee. There's two Jameses here. There's actually four Jameses in the Bible, I think. But it's in the lower part of the back, and it's our solar plexus, which our solar plexus, if that's damaged, you're not going to live. You know, so we got to have good judgment. And sadly, most people's judgment is damaged. They think God's coming to judge the world. They judge people by how they look. One of the new people that's on the health something is with the government, he is a transgender. And I've seen some of the most horrible comments from believers about that man. So their judgment's broken, because the truth is he's righteous and holy, or she wants to go by she, so she's righteous. And so that's important to us. And then number four is love. And that John represents love, and it's in the back of the heart. It's in the cardiac center. And I talk a lot about love. And love, you know, basically without love, none of this works whatsoever. If you don't love, then you're not going to have good judgment. You're not going to have any strength, and you're not going to have good faith. And the love, agape love, I was thinking about this when I was writing it. I've never seen this before, but love, the agape love is love without a cause. There's no cause to it. And I'll explain that. Well, I'll go ahead and tell it. But if you love me because of something, then what happens if that cause goes away? Mm-hmm. If a man meets a woman, so I love you because you're the most beautiful woman in the world, and you make me happy and you make me pleased. And then they marry, and 20 years later, she gains 50 pounds and something happens and she's not the most beautiful. Are you still going to love? So love is without a cause. And number five would be power. That's Philip. It's in the root of the tongue. And there's a lot of power in our tongue, how we speak. And then we have Nathaniel, which is also called Bartholomew. His is imagination. It's between the eyes right here. That's where the imagination takes place. Thomas is in the front of the brain, and that's understanding. Matthew is will. We're going to be talking about will tonight. That's in the center, front of the brain. And then I just got through teaching on Facebook. I teach all these live on Facebook on Sunday at 10 a.m. Central Time with James, again, the other James. And it's order, and that's in the navel. And then number 10 is zeal, which would be Simon the Zealot. It's in the lower part of the back of the head in the medulla. And then number 11 would be Thaddeus, and that's denial or elimination. That's where you let go of some false belief systems. That's the lower part of the back. And then the last one would be Judas, and that's appropriation or life conservation. And that's your generative process. So that's all 12 of those.
Okay. So I think if you have time, if you want to, that even one of these, if you could explain kind of how you got to that point, like, for example, Peter being faith, the center of the head, the pineal gland, how did you come to this revelation? I mean, I think a lot of people are interested in that.
Well, the truth is, let me fix something here on my computer. I want to get down to this one page. The truth is the Western evangelical Christian organizations have hidden many, many teachings from the Middle East from us. People had this mindset that the United States is the only important country to God, and that we're blessed among all other countries. And we are blessed. We really are blessed. But there's so much teaching. See, America's, how old are we? A little over 200 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
A little over 200 years. Well, there's countries that's been around for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
And over the Middle East, there's all kinds of teachings. And I believe a lot of people begin to, even here in America, begin to search spiritual things. And the next thing you know, they call them heretics, you know, or they'll say, oh, that's mystical stuff. You need to stay away from it. You and I have talked about that before. One of my uncles, years ago, I told him I was looking for the symbology of the word, and this was 20-something years ago. He warned me and said that's very dangerous to look for signs and symbols of the word and stay away from it. So there's all kinds of teachings out there that you can find, and I happen to acquire several books that I like a lot, and they're old books. Some of it I don't agree with whatsoever, so I don't really refer them to anybody. But I can gain some good things out of it. So I've seen where there's teaching that actually teach that mm-hmm. part of it, not necessarily what I'm teaching here, but that part of it. I take no credit for what I teach. Nobody should, because all knowledge is from our Father. And whatever you okay. teach and you think it's your first, you're the first one, that I promise you can Google it and you can find somebody else that's taught it.
Right, right. Right.
So faith being the center of the head, which is the pineal gland, if you would, that case taught a tremendous amount of that. And the pineal gland is basically the center where all spiritual energy flows. It has a physical part to it, but more than anything, it has a spiritual function to it. And we've talked about how it literally glows when there's activity going on it. And it's in the physical, it's kind of a discerner between a dark and light, but spiritually it releases light or energy to the entire body. And Peter symbolizes faith in the power of the Spirit, which was literally accelerated to him by watching Jesus's ministry. And the greatest thing that caused Peter to put faith in Father and to really understand the love of God is when he had rejected Jesus and Jesus came and found him after Jesus resurrected himself. And instead of condemning him and saying, "You screwed up," he just said, "Peter, you love my sheep. You love my sheep. You love my sheep." Mm-hmm. And he said, "Go feed them." I mean, I would have been afraid that I was going to be condemned to hell, you know, just like man in the beginning, you know, they told Father they were naked and Father said, "Who told you that?" And then he said, "Have you been feeding on the teachers of the knowledge of good and evil?" He didn't condemn him and he continued to try to put truth on him. So that's what happened with Peter. And he experienced a tremendous love of God. And he experienced at that point in time that he could put total faith in Father God. And like we discussed before, faith is not your faith. Too many times we want to, we say, "Well, I had really strong faith and this happened," or "I had strong faith and that's why that happened." There's even a denomination out there that teaches everything's about your faith, and that's not true. And also we don't put our faith in Jesus and what he did. We put our faith in what Jesus taught, and Jesus taught his Father's faith. So yeah, that's what Peter had to learn, is to put his faith in what Father said from the foundation of the world. And an example of that, one time, I used to fly a lot with my company. I had most of the northeastern part of the United States that I traveled in. And for a long time, I'd get in the plane, I'd be sitting there, and I'd pray over the systems of the airplane and the wings. And, you know, I was putting my faith in my prayer. And I always thought, you know, I prayed, I put my faith in it, I said the prayer right, and I'm going to be okay. But then one day I kind of woke up and thought, you know what? The pilot doesn't necessarily put his faith in his ability to fly the plane. The pilot puts his faith in the creator of the plane, the first person that imagined being able to fly, and all the creators after that. And then he put his faith in the engineers that created the plane and put it together. And that's how the pilot's able to sit down that seat. He knows it's all going to work because he understands the creator. And all of a sudden I begin to realize my faith is in my Father's faith, because when our Father created man, he imaged us, he imagined us in his in the mind, and then he projected us out, and he had full faith that we could have dominion over this earth, we could live eternally, there would be no death or no lack or nothing in us. And that's, to me, that's the faith that Peter learned, which we'll go hear a little bit more here.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, that's really an important thing that I had to learn, was it wasn't about all the prayers or the confessions or the quoting scriptures. It wasn't the ability of doing all of that right. It really was trusting my Father, that what he had spoken and declared and the eternal truth that had been set in order, could I agree with that? And to agree with that, I had to learn that and understand that, but it still wasn't about anything that I could do. And that's the beautiful thing about being his righteousness, or holy because he is holy, and so on.
Right. Well, you know, it's just like we quote scripture all the time, where the scripture said that we have all things that pertain to life and godliness. So people will call me all the time and say, "Well, how do I get that? They still want some kind of law. Well, do I need to fast for 20 hours? Do I need to quit my job and trust God? You know, they got all this stuff. Well, the bottom line is, you need to find out who said that, who spoke that originally, and that came from the foundation of the world, and then you put your faith in that. So if there's a part of our consciousness that's not been accelerated or quickened by understanding that, then we don't move in harmony with our divine mind. And when I talk about our divine mind, I'm talking about Father God. There is only one mind. You know, in my writings, I try to quit saying, I use the brain a lot, because the brain does a lot of thinking. The brain is our hard drive, if you would, but there is a divine mind that that if we allow it to, that function helps us. And if we don't allow it, then it paralyzes these faculties where we're not able to love. We're not able to really have faith because we put our faith in what we see instead of what we know. And then we become paralyzed there. We're not able to love, you know, and our will becomes our will and not Father's will. And if you remember, Jesus said, not my will, Father, but your will.
Yes.
You know, so when the voice of one is freely flowing to our thoughts, because that's where Father speaks to us, then the inner systems, our body are energized at that point. And literally it to the point that every cell in our body is energized. And what seems to be inactivity becomes becomes activity. Mm-hmm. So spiritual thought and real thinking comes forth. And that's what we need, a spiritual thought and real thinking to the point that it even affects our dreams. Mm-hmm. It dominates our entire life.
Yes, absolutely. And I noticed something, not to detour you. I don't know if you're ready to go to the next one or not, but the thing is,
I'm not.
Oh, okay. And I want you to talk about it more, but you know, we know that like the Apostle Paul, who we all have had, taught on a lot. He had a lot of great things to say, a lot of great revelation. I think he had a lot to do with that had to do with his experience on the road to Damascus with Jesus, but he was not one of the original disciples. And you see Peter, James, and John in your list here, and you see Matthew. We don't have Luke. Right. Is there a reason for some of that?
Well, these were the first 12. These were the first 12 disciples. All the rest of them were after that, came after him.
Even though we have the Gospels, Luke was after that.
Yeah, but that's not when they were called. That's not the order in which they were called. I researched that out a lot, and they came later on. You know, just because our Bible's listed, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that's for the people who translate the Bible. That's the people that they put the Bible in order that way. But these people were the first ones that were actually called to Jesus, and then the other ones were added later on.
Yeah, but a lot of attention's been on Peter.
Huh?
A lot of attention in Scripture has been on Peter.
Oh, yeah, the Catholic religion makes him something really powerful, but there's tremendous revelation through him.
Absolutely. You know,
Peter, Second Peter chapter 1, Peter is really encouraging his followers, and he's reminding them of what they were taught by Jesus. And he stated that, I think in verse 14, he said, shortly, I'm going to put off this temple as Jesus revealed to me. So literally Peter, after Jesus had resurrected, Peter had visited with Jesus. And I believe with all my heart, and I taught it when I taught this series, I believe Jesus came back instructed, and still from wherever he went in the world, he appeared to the disciples again, and he instructed them, and he revealed some things to them. So in verse 19, he said, we also have a more sure word of prophecy, where we take heed and we understand and we have knowledge and we understand it until the day star arises in our thoughts. And a star is a revelation. It's an understanding. And it's symbolic of the light that comes from staying in contact with our Father. If you're not in contact with Father, then you don't have much light, because light is understanding. It's spiritual understanding.
Amen.
So I've taught many times over the years, being dead in Christ, to be dead in Christ is simply to be in contact with Father, but not be aware of that.
Yeah.
Father's our source, right? There's a lot of teachers out there that use the word source. We hear Father, we hear Papa. Jesus knew his source, but he called his source Father. And so to be dead in Christ, literally to be dead in contact, is you don't have any knowledge, but you are in contact. But then when there's awareness comes, then you become alive in contact. You become fully aware of that. And then you can hear the divine mind, Father, speaking to your thoughts. I can tell you, in my earlier years in ministry, and I think I've said this to you, my wife used to tell me all the time how the Father said this to her, and she was praying and she heard that. And I was very jealous because I never heard anything. And the truth is, I was in contact, because we all are, but I was dead to that, because I was always praying for something that I didn't realize I already had that knowledge. I was waiting for Father to speak like a blast out of the heavens somewhere.
Yeah.
When I finally woke up someday and realized I can hear the voice, I calm myself down and I listen. So this divine mind, which Peter's name symbolizes, is faith. Faith is perceiving power. It's the power that shapes substance, if you would. It's a spiritual assurance that seems impossible to many people, you know, but I know very well in study of the scripture that we are supernatural. The Bible plainly teaches that we are supernatural. And that really means that's, you know, some people say the natural body, well, my natural body is a supernatural body. It's unnatural to be anything else. It's unnatural to be sick. You know, like you and I discussed our knees and our legs, it's unnatural for our knees not to function properly.
Yes.
And so literally when we perceive and we link up and by faith, we link up and we practice thinking on these things that the Apostle Paul says, it's like a magnetic power that draws spiritual and invisible spiritual substance to come forth in your life. And it's faith that's a deep inner knowing that assures you that it's already yours.
Mm-hmm.
And people ask me all the time, and I'm sure they ask you, how do I pray? How do I pray? I pray, the word prayer actually means conversation. That's all it means. So when I have a conversation with my Father, a lot of it is thanksgiving. I am thankful that the Father has me where I'm at today. And I say that, Father, I thank you for where I'm at today. I thank you that I do have, I have my eyes to see. And I'm thankful that I hear your voice. And then the only thing I ever ask for, the word ask means to ascertain, seek, and desire to know a thing. So I just say, Father, help me as I translate scripture. Help me as I study to really come up with the living word, the truthful word, because I want to make people free. And I want to make myself free. And make means experience.
Absolutely.
So now faith is faith in Papa's faith. Hebrews 11:1. People talk about now faith. And I know a lot of people say, well, now faith means I want it right now. You know, I expect it right now. But now faith is assurance of things that we have expected. I don't expect it anymore. I know it's mine because it's Papa's faith.
Yeah. And you know, just to jump back just a short ways to prayer, in one of my books on Amazon, it's a book of quotes. And one of my favorite quotes in the book is that prayer is simply communication between two people in love. And you can know that you have a love relationship with Father once you get to understand that he loves you unconditionally.
That's right.
And I love that faith in Father's faith in Papa's faith.
Right.
I think that's another aspect that people need to become comfortable with, that he's not just God all the time. And that's your only focus. He's something more intimate. Papa, Father, you Daddy.
Know, my grandkids, the ones that are around me all the time, and the ones in Florida know it too. They do know it. But if I tell them I'm going to do something for them, I have never failed them in that, ever. If I told them I was going to take them to ice cream store, I've taken them to ice cream store. I have a 25-year-old grandson that became a lawyer. And first of all, I asked him, I said, I'm really proud for you. And I know you love to dress up. I know you love to wear watches and jewelry. So Papa's going to send you my Movado watch that I won from my company. And he said, thank you, because I taught him always to say thank you. Well, a week and a half later, he got that watch. And he never doubted that watch wasn't going to come. So he never called me back and said, Papa, please give me that watch. He never prayed to ask that it would come. He just knew it because he knows me. And that's the reason people can't put faith in Father, because they have their own perception of Father.
Mm-hmm.
They're still, and that's why the last one of these teachings I'm going to teach on Judas is elimination. We have to eliminate the lie that we've been taught about our Father. We have to eliminate the idea of penal substitution. And people are still fighting me and Kay for penal substitution. They just can't let it go. Well, until you let it go, you're going to be sick. Just like in my body, I have a digestive system. And if I don't let it go, everybody knows that's very uncomfortable, isn't it?
And, absolutely. And literally,
if it blocks, you can die.
Absolutely.
So we've got to allow comforter teachers to come into our life and teach us about who our Father is. And to have faith in Papa's faith is true faith. That's real faith. And faith is more than just believing. Faith is more than just hoping. It's the very substance of that which we believe for. In other words, I don't have faith that I'm going to get a brand new car tomorrow. All I do is I have faith that if as long as I live, if there's a need for a car, I will have a car.
Mm-hmm.
As long as I live, if there's need for a $100 bill, there will be a $100 bill that way. And I've lived that way since 1996. And I'm telling you, it's a great way to live. And, you know, and I'm practicing, if I can say it that way, I'm believing the same thing for my health. You know, I'm saying, Lord, as long as I live, you are my health. You're not my healer. You're my health. Yeah. And I believe that's coming forth to the point that I'm going to eliminate from my awareness all the stuff that's anti that. So we must release these thoughts of condemnation and enmity and resistance, and we must declare and embrace this divine love. Then faith works unhindered.
There's this very famous, very popular preacher that teaches a lot on grace and has really done a great job up to a certain point. And I used to listen to this person a lot, and it's gotten to where it's like, okay, yes, that's really good, but take us to the next step. Come on, go to that next step. And it seems like we did that in some of our past experiences. If we made our scripture confessions every day and we prayed our list of prayers every day, then we knew because we did that, everything was going to be okay. When really that motivation of, if I don't do it, is a motivation of fear. I'm doing it now because of fear. And that's not trusting in Father.
No, not at all. See, I was that way all my life, and everybody probably was. I was set under preachers and ministers of the young man, and they'd tell us what we need to do, but they never told us how. Never. Yeah. And I kept thinking, okay, how? Tell me how to do it. Well, they didn't know how either. But there is no how, you know, and I think that's where we're at now. It's who. It's who did it. It's who said it. Who made me this way? You know, who was the first person that dreamed of an airplane? The Wright brothers, right? You know, they dreamed of an airplane and people, and then they flew, and then people took hold of that and made it greater and greater and greater. So my faith in an airplane is who put that together. And I know all knowledge comes from Father. So first of all, it's Father, but that's where my faith comes from. And so without putting our faith in Father, then our next step here would be Matthew, and that's will. And our will is really out of order. And we have some people have a really strong will. You know, I've got a grandson that we're trying to help him with it, but boy, he's one that just puts his arms together, and you know, he's got a strong will, and it's very hard to bend him. And that's where a lot of people are. And that's interesting that Matthew's English, the English name Matthew, was translated from Matthilios. I don't pronounce it very well. And it comes from Makomi, and it means to war, to quarrel, and to dispute. And then his Greek name, starting with math, and the war, quarrel, and dispute would fit very well to be a tax collector. He had a very strong will. And that's in the center of your brain. It's right up here. And you know, when somebody gets stubborn and they get strong will, what do? They scrunch up all this area up here and yes. They get tight. And I'm not going to do that, you know, or I may be sitting down, but I'm really standing up, you know, so that's what that pictures. And, I believe, and I've heard Kay mention this before, and this freaks people out sometimes because a Christian religion doesn't like these phrases, but I believe that for quite a while, we've been in the age of Aquarius. And it's very common among astrologers that see age Aquarius as when humanity begins to take control of the earth again. And that's what needs to happen. We need to quit praying and asking God to do something and said, it's all going to work out. It's all going to pan out. And we need to realize this is our home. I've heard many people over the last year where all the turmoil in the political realm, and they'll say, oh, I don't care. I'm not going to be here anyways, because their hope is in a rapture. You know, yeah. I'll say, well, what are you going to do? You're going to die or what? You know, but this planet is our rightful heritage. Living in the cool of the day in this planet, which is as the breath of God, is our rightful heritage. And the systems of the earth, I believe there will be a day that we won't need them. But until we can get to that place, again, I believe righteous-minded people can get involved and take over the political system, the religious system, and the medical system, and the financial system. If we would quit teaching our children they don't need to be involved, just come to church and pay your tithe and hang on till Jesus comes. And that's what's really hurt us.
Yeah.
But many people, astronomers believe around 2021 is the really beginning of that. And where we realize Earth is our home and we do have dominionship over it because the Father gave us dominionship and mastership over the Earth. So the will is in the center of the brain. It's right beneath the cerebral cortex, and it serves as the main thought and control center of the entire brain. So if you have a will, and again, I haven't mentioned this, but everybody's familiar with it. The Apostle Paul in Romans said after he taught them everything about what man had done from the foundation, who we are, what Jesus revealed, how Jesus brought it into the religious system and everything. He said, now, because of all that, don't be conformed to this world system anymore or the world ways, but be ye transformed by the renewing mind. Well, most people want the transformation process, right? Mm-hmm. But they forget the place where it says, don't be conformed. Mm-hmm. And so we've got to unconform ourselves. And we do that by listening to our divine mind, listen to the Father. But we've got to, our will has been conformed to that which is carnal. And so it's even has hindered our physical body and our brain. So yeah. It's the seat of higher level of thought, the seat of emotions and decision-making. And it actually can affect our balance, our movement, and our reflexes. So with Matthew's spiritual faculty symbolizing the will, we want to experience a baptism of our conscious awareness and our subconscious that will free us from limitations. And see, that's what Jesus pictured to us. He never was affected by limitations in the physical realm whatsoever.
Right.
If he needed to walk on water, he could. If there wasn't enough bread, he could multiply that bread. You know the stories. And but carnally minded people that are not listening to the Father, there's all kinds of limitations. And the biggest one is thinking that we don't have these things. And the very fact that we ask God for healing, it's a limitation. We don't admit that we have health in us already. And I'm not speaking against people that ask for healing. If that's where you're at, do it. I mean, I would love a miracle to take place in my body right now with my knee. But the bottom line is, if I get a miracle, then something else is going to come along later on. I want to get to the place where I need no healing whatsoever. Yes. That we live in a no need realm. And yep. So we need our will to come into contact with Father. You can interrupt me when you want.
Well, no, you're going great. And I'm saying yes. And that's really my amen. Okay. But you know, the thing is that until we really believe we are created supernaturally as Father created us like himself. Yeah. And here we have a Father who needs no healing, who has no lack, who has nothing limited within his own person. Until we really believe that and really get that, all of the junk out of us that is opposed to that. Do you know there are people who believe that the physical body is only limited because we believe that it's limited?
Right. Well, think of this. I'm going to preface what I say, so what I'm going to say after that won't be so shocking to people. Okay. I read this the other day in a book I'm reading from somebody back in 1895. My father's name is Richmond. And my father had a home to live in, and he had a certain amount of money to live out of. But until I admitted that I was a Richmond, I wouldn't be comfortable with that, and I wouldn't enjoy all that, and I wouldn't receive all that, right?
Okay.
If I just said, oh no, I'm not a Richmond. I'm just a carnal, I'm just a poor person. I'm just a sinner, if you would, or whatever. And so the problem with mankind today, the Bible says ye are gods, right? Mm-hmm. And I know it says Elohim, and it says in the ordinary sense. In other words, what that's saying is, God Almighty is our source, but we are the plural of Father. And so one of the greatest hindrances to man today is they won't put down all these lies that we've been said, or told that we're just sinners or sinners saved by grace, and admit I am God. Mm-hmm. Not God Almighty, but I am, God is my source, right? And I am of Father. So everything that God is, I am. So you don't have to say I am God, but I'm telling you, you can say I am as God in the earth, and everything that Father God is, I am too. And that's the big hindrance, because we don't want to say that.
Right. And isn't it amazing that David, in his writings, declares the the eternal truth from the beginning of time in saying that God has created us not only like himself, but he's crowned us with glory and honor, and he's given us the, you might as well say, dominion over all the work of his hands. I mean, everything that God did, he has put in our hands as his creation. And so when we believe that we're not in, you know, someone said the other day that, you know, the government's in charge, and I said, no, they're not, I am. Right. What I meant by that is, as a believer who believes that I am, my, God is my source and I am of the source, that I'm really calling the shots, even though more and more, as you said before the show, more of us got to get on the same page about that.
Well, and, think about this.
Go ahead.
Go down to the Gulf of Mexico and dip a cup and bring some water out of that and bring it home to you. Is that the ocean?
No, it's just a small place.
But no, but it's still, it's
the ocean. But it's of the ocean.
It is the ocean.
Yeah.
It's not the whole ocean, but when you look at that water, that's ocean water. It's got salt in it. It's got everything that the ocean has in it, or the Gulf of Mexico has in it.
Just we are of the source.
It's going to be kind of dark a little bit, but that's what I'm trying to get the point across there.
Yeah.
So everything that Father is, we are that today. So I don't have to walk around saying I'm God. I mean, people would think I'm stupid, and I am not God Almighty, but I am as God. And I've got to know that in my mind, that as Father is, I am. Just like we want to say the first race of man, what do we call ourselves today? We're mankind, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're not different than the first. God created man, Adam. We're Adam. We're the same thing. So again, that's the hindrance. So when we really wake up to that, then I would call that the New Jerusalem environment. That wasn't always our true home. New Jerusalem is an experiential place living that, if in the world, when the world's falling apart right now, a lot of it, the systems they're going to, we experience our experiences, sure, and our experiences at peace. In Revelation 3:12 in the King James, it says, "Him that overcometh, I will make a pillar in the temple of God, and he shall go no more out. I will write upon him the nature of my God." That's what name means. And the name of that city, or the nature of that city of my God, which is New Jerusalem. So that's who we are, but we need to experience that.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. It's just like the city of God. There's one city. That's the
city.
Source.
City is a people. We are that. One of my worship leaders that wrote a song, she wrote a song called "I Am That City."
Yes.
I am. And we got to know that. I want to read one of my translations from Revelation. Revelation 3:12. It says, "To him who has a clear, keen, and knowledgeable understanding, and can speak swiftly of the understanding that Jesus' judgment by the Pharisees ended the Mosaic law and the sacrificial system, I will cause that one to receive an infinite awareness of righteousness being in all men." And when we say men, we mean women too. I know everybody knows that. "Mm-hmm. As my most holy place temple, and he or she shall dwell, shall no longer be without understanding. And I will engrave in his or her conscious awareness, knowledge of their holy character, their image, and my supreme divine nature. So also is the true character, life, and image of all people. As I exist, they exist." The phrase "I am" actually means I exist. "All of them are my most holy place dwelling place. He or she has understanding, who has understanding, dwells in and draws from their holy breath, supplied by my supreme divine nature within. Therefore, they are as me." And that's what Revelation 3:12 says. I read it to you earlier in the King James.
Amen.
So yes. Our will needs to be conformed to our source. Without that, we just live with some kind of free will to do whatever we want to. And the truth is, you can. But the way they're in is destruction. But if you'll conform your will to the will of the Father, and that's for you to live as Father with no lack whatsoever, then that faculty right there itself will be the driving force, along with love, to every one of the other faculties.
Amen. Amen. I'm not going to stop you. Just go right ahead.
All right. So the true spiritual being, really not male or female, because there's no male or female in Father. I'm not saying we're not male or female. There's definitely, we're birthed that way. But as far as in spirit, there's no male or female in us. We're a spirit And the Father is where the will is, Matthew. There is where the will is, the faculty. It has an establishment that needs to take place, and we need to be established in these things. And the problem is today is people jump from teaching to teaching to teaching, and they never stay with one minister long enough to really learn. And I, every time somebody calls me, I tell them, I said, you know, you need to pick, you need to let the Father lead you to a minister that can help you grow up and help you mature, and stick with that minister, stick with that teacher, and be established. But too many people are jumping here and there, and they're trying to find somebody that's going to give them an answer on how to just change instantly. It's kind of like I always joke, Father, give me patience and give it to me right now.
Yeah.
So when we recognize this truth by means of the will, we give up our mortal ideas. And we consecrate ourselves with our faculties to a spiritual expression. And again, concentrate means to see something. When the priests were consecrated, they saw something. So we need to see it for ourselves, because then our faculties will become spiritual expressions and not carnal expressions. Because you know yourself, you can have carnal love, right? Mm-hmm. And your will can be carnal, and all these other things I'm talking about. There's carnal tools to try to eliminate things. You can go to psychologists if you got something that's hindering you, but they're not going to bring perfection to you. There's always an anti in the world, whatever Father wants for us. So when we do this, our holy breath, then it supplants and it succeeds inside of us, and we get past all which is sensual, and we realize that we, in truth, we're spiritual, and we perfectly function in every area of our life, and that's the way our Father created us. So in the regeneration, we control, we direct, we teach, and we bring discipline to the faculties of our brain. And to do this, we have to, in a measure, we have to free ourselves from greed, from material things. Because, you know, how many times you've been to meetings where it's all about getting money and getting wealth?
Exactly.
And, you know, when the Bible talks about the power to get wealth, he's talking about wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. If God would wanted to give us all kinds of wealth, Solomon would have asked for money, but Solomon knew God's heart. And he understand, and he said, I want wisdom and knowledge. I want to know how to lead these people. And that's what I want to do. We all have a following on Facebook, the people that are ministering truth. You know, I have like 4,900 connections, but I only have like 1,000 followers. And I almost wish some of those people wouldn't follow me, because they're taking up all the place where I could get more people. But there are people that are following, and we want to say, Father, help me. I want to be able to bring people to this place where they give up getting money. You know, it's okay to work, but this is not about having material things. This is about having spiritual understanding, spiritual wisdom, and functioning out of that with power. And the power is love. Jesus never used his supernaturalness for himself, ever. And there are master teachers in the earth that's been here for many, many years, and they never use their ability for themselves. It was always for other people.
Yeah, our relationship with Father has to be the motivation, not the money, not be the motivation.
Right. And blessing other people.
Yeah.
You know, that's why Jesus said it's better to give than it is to receive. Mm-hmm. And so the will faculty always enters into our decision. The will makes the final choice to give up or to follow something. There is a will if you want to follow the way, the truth, and the life. And that's what happened when Jesus came to these disciples and he said, follow me. And they used their will, they tapped in, and they just stood up and followed him. I mean, can you imagine? Matthew was a tax collector and had a lot of responsibility, and he just stood up and left it all, and all the other disciples. And so the will has been given over to our thought. And if our thought's not listening to the Father, then we're all about gathering more wealth. So in the rejuvenation, we're experiencing the will has been converted, if you would, and is taught to converse and meditate and stabilize the substance in our body where it's under the will of the Father, not ours. And if we don't, all your will is a parasite. It's all it is. It's just sucking off of everybody else. But when our individual will becomes one, we stay in contact with Father, then literally I exist. We exist. and we rule over this entire planet in righteousness.
I believe for a long time that we were created spirit, soul, and body, in our origin. But I had difficulty understanding that we were spirit, soul, and body in this natural realm. But if you are spirit, as Kay preaches, Dr. Kay, that we're spirit slowed down to visibility, it doesn't mean you changed who you are. You just became visible, or you were now in an appearance realm, but you're still spirit, soul, and body as spirit.
We took on the form of a body, but the truth is my body is spirit.
Exactly.
You know, we all used to teach that mind, will, the three-part being, and really we're not a three-part being. Now, a person that's not seeking spiritual understanding or whatever, say you're crazy. Yes, we are, but we're not. We're one. The Lord our God is one, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what the Bible says, and I have translated that, and that's exactly what it says. The Lord our God is one, and so I am one, and yeah, you see a physical body here, but this body is spirit too.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. So, and that's the place you have to come in.
I'm a living soul.
Right.
The Bible said God made man and made him a living soul. Mm-hmm. So it's all spirit. Every bit of it is. So there is no such thing as spirit, soul, and body. It's all one. And see, that's because we see division there. And, you know, and that's where, and I don't want to step on any toes, but even the Trinity, they came up with a division, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Well, Father is spirit. So how can there be Father and a separate Holy Ghost?
Mm-hmm.
Father is spirit. The Bible says they Father is spirit, which that's a Latin word, but it really says Father is breath. And they who want to know him must seek him in breath and truth. So there is no separation with Father and spirit. And there's no separation with Father and Son. And every place you look in Scripture where it says Son, if you'll look it up, click on the Greek or Hebrew, it says a Son. It does not say Son. Mm-hmm. And the word begotten means one who stayed in their original birth state. Mm-hmm. So Jesus was the one in his time that he lived in that area, that he was the only one that stayed in his original birth state. And it said he was a Son of God, because we are a Son of God and we are a daughter of God also.
Right. And we've got to get past that we don't see, that we see God as anything but one. He is not a picture of separation. He didn't create us as a picture of separation. And then the two are not two. There is no separation. That's one thing we've been really trying to hammer on a lot, is there's no separation.
Right. And remember, I think it's Hosea. I read it too many times on these meetings, but in Hosea, in the King James, it says, we shall live in his sight.
Mm-hmm.
Well, shall is actually exists.
Exactly.
Right. And the word sight is the plural of a noun. When you look it up, it says the plural of a noun. So literally, we live as God. We exist as God. That's what he was saying. That was way back for anybody supposed to get born again, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
Way back then. So he was saying, we exist as God. We are the plural of Father God. And we have these divine faculties in us. If we will allow the very spirit, the voice of God to speak into our spirit, or into our thoughts, excuse me, and then we allow ourselves to conform to that. And while we're doing that, we eliminate everything that's hindered that and just say, I'm putting that down. I'm not fighting to keep that anymore. You know, it's kind of like Paul Young's book, The Shack, and Mac was asking Papa about judgment and, you know, all this. And she just looked at him and said, how's that working for you?
Yeah.
People need to answer that question. How is your belief system working for you? And if you'll be honest with you, if you're not believing the truthful word, it ain't working.
Yeah.
It's not working. It's making you mean, making you judgmental, making you attack people that's trying to teach the truth, right?
Yeah.
So,
absolutely.
That's why I don't have a congregation. Nobody can throw tomatoes at me.
It's hard to do through a computer screen or.
Yeah, they can just put unlike or frown on there.
So, now, Dr. Roy, is this going to become a book?
Oh yeah, I've got my first volume that I'm writing. I'm going to try to get it. I'm just going to commit that by the end of the next month, I'm going to have the first book done. And I'm still teaching from the second book, and there'll probably be three or four volumes of it. that it's called the divine, the spiritual code and symbology of the living word. That's what the title will be.
And will this be multiple volumes? You said volume
one. I think so. I think this is the way I'm going to go most of my life. I want to go through the entire Bible and just search out the symbology of the names of people. It's amazing. I've been doing a lot of studying on the chronological genealogies, and every one of those names, every person in there, their name has something to do with the nature of God. But they had a choice. They had a will. They could live out of it or they didn't live out of it. But every one of them, and it's just a great picture that everyone has Father God in them.
Amen. Everyone. We can choose to live out of his nature and be more than we ever thought we could be, not trying to be more than who God created us as, but right. purely live out of his nature, his character, him as source, and life just improves.
Right. What we've tried to do as immature people, all of us, immature spiritual life, we've tried to conform God to our will.
Yeah.
Right? Instead of saying, not my will, yours, our prayers are always saying, Father, I want this house. I want this husband, this wife. I want to raise. We've all been there. So we're having a good time.
Amen.
If I may, I still want to encourage people, and people are starting to get it. Not that I make any money. I make very little. I'm not. But order my translation of the book of Romans. I'm telling you, it will help you so much. It's a poetic flow, and it's not because of what I've done, but it's the very spirit of God in there. It's just people told me that they read it all in one sitting. And then I just remembered I got Galatians, so I'm going to publish that too pretty soon. But I want everybody to have that Romans book. It's not that expensive, and it'll be a great tool for you.
Would you put the link in the chat room where people can find your books?
I will, but all they have to do is go to Dr. Roy E, as in Edward Richmond.com, and click on the book link. But yes, I will put it there when we get off.
Dr. Roy E. Richmond.com, and you can find his books there. I announced in the pre-show that you had 68 books. I know that has increased.
Some of those are irrelevant now.
I know, but they do have your name on them if anybody finds them.
Not published.
Yeah. So, we do, we thank God we do grow in revelation knowledge, and that's essential. It's important.
I still have in my computer because now I can go back and say, oh, this is what that meant. So it's a help to me. I just wouldn't publish them.
Right. Well, we appreciate your contribution to, I want to say the body of Christ, but really what I mean is to the creation of God.
The body of contact. We're in contact with the source.
Amen. Yep. And so is the person as someone would view as the ultimate of bad people on earth. They are connected to the source. They just haven't been awakened to that truth yet. And so, yeah.
And most of that's religious people, to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
Who did Jesus speak against? The Pharisees. They're the ones. Anybody that's religious minded, they're dead. They're dead in contact with God.
Yeah. If you look at the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and you're seeing it, when we talk about being free from religious mindedness, just look at the New Testament, the Gospels, and see who Jesus combated with. A lot of times it was religious minded people.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So, I love you. Appreciate you letting me do this.
All right. You're so welcome. And hey, everybody, if you would click like and then click share, let people know about this broadcast tonight. And then join me in the morning at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time with Apostle Brian Christian as we continue to talk about we've been having a lot of fun with this topic. So we will see everybody then. Have a great evening. Thank you again, Dr. Roy. He's going to be posting the link where you can find his books, but Dr. Roy E. Richmond.com. And it'll take you right where you need to be. We appreciate y'all. Blessings to you. Bye-bye and good night, everyone.
Bye.
was religious-minded people.
That's exactly right.